my dear students, today's chapter is called Intercultural Communication. From the name of the chapter, you can detect that it has the same name as the name of the course that we have studied previously on L1. Our course name was Intercultural Communication. So the good news is that this chapter and the course that we studied has common aspects. You'll find that the chapter carries many of the information found on your previous course. So the good news is that you will find that chapter 3 is identical to your previous course. So you are not going to take too much time in studying and reading chapter 3. So let's start. Okay, markets go global. Why markets think about going globally? Because mergers, acquisition, and buyouts telegraph beyond national boundaries. American companies in global market must adapt to other culture. Increasingly, even many homegrown businesses are controlled by global trends fueling globalization. Declining of domestic markets, as we said previously, that domestic markets are full now, so it's the era of invading new markets in new areas. And the removal of a trade barrier plus the new technological advancement, it helped in the breakthrough and the growing middle classes in the emerging communities and the advancement in transportation and logistics. All of these led to globalization. Characteristics of culture. As we studied before, culture is learned. Culture are logical, inherited. As you know your culture from your parents. Culture is dynamic, it's changing. You can imagine that previously culture of our parents is different from culture of today. That's because it's changing, it's not always the same. Culture is the basis of self-identity and community. Yes, because I learned from my parents or inherited that this is our culture and how I see myself and my community. So it's the thing that creates our identity. Culture combines the visible and the invisible. What's inside you, your character, and how you behave, your belief, your thoughts, your morals, all of these are combined under the umbrella term of dimensions of culture. We have high and low context, time orientation, individualism and collectivism, communication style and power distance. High and low context, as we studied before, that we have in some culture, we have the high context. They depend on the context to understand meaning. They are not direct. Not everything is mentioned in words. While in the low context culture, everything is direct. The word carries the meaning. They are linear. As for the time orientation, for some culture, time is important. They want speedy decisions, for example, like the Americans. Unlike, for example, people in Japan, to take a decision, they need some time to think about it. In other culture, maybe if you have an appointment, they may wait for 2 or 3 hours after the appointment because time is not that important for them. But for example, the agent in general are punctual. Whenever they have a meeting at 10, then it's 10 the meeting will start. Individualism and collectivism. Individualism like the American culture and collectivism like most of the Asian country. They are working together. It's important to have relationships. Communication style. Again, it depends on the high and the low context. Power distance. It creates the relation between, for example, the manager and the employees. For example, in the American culture, because the power distance is not that great, so maybe employees can call the manager with his name, they can have an opinion. Unlike some of the Asian countries, they are believing in the importance of having spaces between the manager and the employees and the hierarchy. So they don't speak directly with their manager. They just have to obey without expressing their own opinions. High and low context culture. Low context tend to be logical, linear, action oriented, as we said. The high context, rational, collectivist, intuitive, and contemplative, as we said. Leave much unsaid, and they depend on the posture, voice, inflection, gesture, and facial. Communication style. As we said, the low contacts, they depend on the word, directness and openness. People tend to be informal, impatient and literal. As for the high contacts, they're verbal. Characteristics of high and low contacts culture: relational, collectivist, intuitive, contemplative. Unlike the low contact, they are logical, linear, individualistic, action oriented. How we form judgments. As we studied in our intercultural course before, that stereotype is one of the form of judgment. What do we mean by stereotype? Oversimplified behavioral pattern applied uncritically to groups. It's negative. So stereotype is that I believe that, for example, Indians are idiots. So this is stereotype. I said that all Indians are idiots. This is negative and this is not true. Because India, not all the Indians are idiot. Have I had a relation with all the Indians to generalize that all of them are idiots? And this is not true one more time, because now India is a great economic power. So definitely this is not true. Or another example, that all the Mexicans are lazy. Again, this is not. Another form of judgment is prejudice. Prejudice, attitude based on erroneous beliefs or preconceptions. So it's a pre. So I assume something without even meeting a person or without dealing with people from this culture. So it's previous conceptions. I imagine that people or this person is doing this or that or has this bad behavior without even dealing with these people. And again, it's something negative. How we form judgment? Prototype. A prototype is different. It's positive. Mental representation based on characteristics that are flexible, open to new definitions. So it's not like stereotype that I generalize that all the people from this culture are having the same characteristic. It's a flexible, it's open to new definition, it can be changed. So prototype is good, but stereotype is negative. So what are techniques for achieving intercultural competence? Being descriptive, give descriptive feedback instead of judgmental one. It means that instead of just saying that this person is bad or this culture is lazy or people in this culture are stupid or whatever, try to give descriptive feedback. Describe. Non-judgmentalism. Don't be judgmental. Be tolerant. Help to prevent defensive reaction. Be supportive. Encourage others with head nods, eye contact, and facial expressions. If you do this, then this would achieve intercultural. Improving conversation in intercultural environment. Learn foreign phrases. Try to learn from the language of the person you are communicating with. Observe eye messages. We said that non-verbal messages are important, such as eye contact. Use simple English. So if the person in front of you, his first language is not English, so it's better to use simple English instead of using complex language. So this would lead to miscommunication. Speak slowly and clearly, and this is important. Encourage accurate feedback is important to make sure that the one understands what you are saying and he understands totally the message you are trying to deliver. Enhancing intercultural oral communication. Accept blame. Smile when appropriate. Listen without interrupting. Follow up in writing. All of this would enhance, would improve the oral communication. Now let's move to written communication. What would improve the written communication? Adjust your writing style and tone. Make sure, am I writing in a formal or an informal language? What should be my tone? Avoid humor to prevent misunderstanding, because now you are dealing with people from different culture. So maybe something that is humorous for you is offensive to other people. So be aware of this, or vice versa. Use short sentences, short paragraphs to make the language clear. Observe title and rank of the person with or writing this message to. Avoid ambiguous expressions. No need for ambiguous expression because this may lead to miscommunication. Strive for clarity. Clarity is important. Use correct grammar, cite numbers. Anti-bribery laws. The idea of bribery is somehow crucial because in some countries it's not considered a bribe. It's something which is legal. In other countries it might be a bribery and this is illegal. We have the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act of 1977, which prohibit payment to foreign official for the purpose of obtaining or retaining business, apply only to US companies. And then we have the Act of 2002, a tool in anti-corruption battle for bits off the book bribes. And we have the global treaty promoted by the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development in 1999, ban bribery of foreign government officials. So for example, in America, bribery is illegal. Maybe in other country it's not illegal. It's something which is usual in order to obtain the job or to have this deal, you have to pay. So that's why we provide you with ethical decision making across borders. Broaden your view, avoid reflex judgment, find alternative, reviews business if option variety or basic values. Because maybe considering the part of the bribe, if am I dealing with in a country and in this country you have to pay to get the business and you are now a citizen, a US citizen, and this is called bribery and this is illegal, what should you do? Should you pay for this people in order to get the job or to get the deal done, or you shouldn't do this? So this came with the idea of being ethical. As we said previously, is it right or wrong? So you need to find alternative and to refute the business if you think that it violates your basic values. I have values and a code of morals. I wouldn't change this in order to have a deal done or to do this job. Embrace transparency. Transparency is important. Resist legalistic strategies. Resist doing the part of that this is legal in the other country and it's not illegal, then I'll do it just to make the deal or to have this deal. Don't rationalize the decision. And then remember the 5 questions. Ask yourself this question frequently. Whenever you are in a problem and you are not sure is it ethical or not, ask yourself the 5 questions again. Is the action legal? Would I do it if I were on the opposite side? Can I roll out a better alternative? If there is an alternative, then go for it. Would a trusted advisor agree? Would family, friend, employer, co-worker approve? Benefits of workplace diversity. What are the benefits of working in a diverse place? If you have a diverse staff member, this is better able to read trend, respond to diverse customers, more likely to see opportunities that a homogeneous group would miss. Because we have different perspectives, different experiences. So this would help. In diverse team, better equipped to create product that markets require, come up with creative, effective problem solving. Diverse consumers want to deal with companies, as we said, that respect their value, respect their morals, know what they want, demand specialized and services tailored to their needs. Because everyone in the team would know that the needs and the services and the goods directed to people in his culture. Companies that figure out the diversity challenge have a competitive advantage because they have many consumers and they have diverse and different perspectives, so they can know what people would want and they can provide this to all people. So it's a win-win situation for everyone. Benefits of workplace diversity to businesses. Companies that cultivate diversity suffer fewer discrimination lawsuits, fewer union clashes, less government scrutiny. Diversity is a critical bottom line business strategy to improve employee relationship, increase productivity. Government and corporation increasingly contract only with supplier who can show cultural readiness. They know how to deal with people from different cultures. Improving communication among diverse workplace audiences. Seek training. Understand the value of differences. Don't expect conformity. Make fewer assumptions. Build on narratives. That's it for chapter 3. You have to read this chapter in your book, and you'll find many similar information to what we have studied in our previous course. Now let's move to the discussion and your discussion. You have a scenario, and you need to answer 3 questions based on this scenario. Your company is moving toward final agreement on a contract in another country to sell farm equipment. The official wants you to pay money. Your colleagues all seem to agree that this is common practice in the other country. The extra amount is going to the official you have worked with. Your supervisor is pressuring you to do whatever it takes to close the deal. So now you are in a dilemma, in an ethical dilemma. Would you follow the rules or can you find an alternative? What should you do? Now you need to answer these 3 questions. What are 2 or more ethical complexities you can identify when working with another country? What is 1 advantage to working with a foreign country? Should your company pay the large amount to get the deal closed? Why or why not? So this is for your discussion. Now, for your assignment, again, you have another scenario. But this time, you imagine that your co-worker had just assigned by your company to work in South Korea for 3 months. Your co-worker are asking your help because you have an experience with working with other cultures. So, what you are supposed to do? You need to prepare to follow the steps below and write a response in a Word document to your co-worker. You need to answer this question. Your essay to be including the answers for this question. How do employees in South Korea communicate in the office? How do they dress? Document your key findings. You need to write references. Compare what you found out about South Korea business with the business conducted in the state. Then you are going to hold a comparison based on the following points. Put together a list of 6 to 8 tips to help your co-worker be successful in this new workplace culture. So that's it for your assignment. Thank you, my dear students. Hope everything would be great.